Why do people get obsessed with true crime? Why are people, myself included, fascinated by serial killers? I'm a neuroscientist and psychiatrist, and in this video, I'm going to try to provide some answers. The first reason of these actually relates to all of the other reasons in some form or another, and that reason is survival instinct. Animal brains in general give more weight and attention to potential threats than potential rewards. Because in evolutionary terms, missing a potential threat is game over for your genes. You know, ignoring that rustling in the bushes that turns out to be a saber-toothed tiger, you can't afford to do that even once. Whereas missing out on a potential new source of food in your environment, not a huge deal. You can probably find berries tomorrow, right? You're not going to die immediately. So this same principle, I think, accounts for why today we might pay more attention to bad guys than good guys. Serial killers, for example, are like that saber-toothed tiger, but instead of rustling in the bushes, they're doing what exactly? Well, that question, I think, is why we're so drawn to true crime. So let's talk about how our brain normally detects threats. The key region involved in threat detection is the amygdala. As your brain is parsing through the barrage of information that's coming in from your environment, the amygdala is scanning that information, looking for potential threats to flag. And when it flags something as a threat, there are two pathways from the amygdala. One, which we'll call the slow pathway, is sending that information to your higher order cortical regions, which process complex information, and in this case, can figure out whether that thing is really a threat. In humans, this is when you become consciously aware of something. This is what it is to think about something. It's your higher order cortical regions processing information. But again, this takes... Whoa! So the other pathway is the fast pathway. And this is what gets immediately engaged if the amygdala flags something as a potential threat that's dangerous enough. Something that could kill you in a moment, like a snake which could have lethal venom. That's dangerous enough that the amygdala is going to send a signal to go into fight or flight mode immediately. It may even trigger reflex motor behaviors. So an example of this fast pathway is what happens if you put a cucumber behind a cat. The cat freaks out. This is pre-thinking. This is a reflex behavior because the cat's amygdala has sent a signal that, hey, that could be a poisonous snake, so get out of here. You got to get out of here. In time, that slower, higher cortical pathway is still getting engaged. And so the cat realizes after that initial reflex that, okay, wait, that's not actually a snake, okay? So then the cat may decide to investigate the cucumber, you know, give it a sniff, figure out what the deal is. That's that slow pathway that happens after that immediate reflex motor behavior, that fight or flight mode. So let's get back to true crime. I think if you're scanning your environment for something to do, let's say, there are aspects of true crime that might in fact engage that fast pathway, immediately get flagged by your amygdala and put you in kind of a state of excitement. You know, your heart rate might speed up just from looking at some of these sensational thumbnails or seeing a cover of a book, and that reflex might be just clicking on the thumbnail or pulling the book off of the shelf, just instinctively. But the part that's really going to keep you engaged is that slow pathway. Once the amygdala is sending it to your higher order cortex, you start paying conscious attention to it. And at that point, you realize, oh, this definitely is worth continuing paying attention to. You know, you find that you're quite curious to learn more. And that leads me to morbid curiosity. So wanting to understand a killer isn't as perverse as it seems. It's actually quite natural, in my opinion. Because again, the difference between the kind of predators our brains are good at detecting, the ones they can detect easily, like a snake or beast of some sort, versus psychopathic killers, is that the latter can hide in plain sight. When we become aware that there are people that seem normal, that look normal, or even seem charming, that might actually be cold-blooded killers, we're going to feel like we need to figure out who they are. We need some system to detect these people. Otherwise, what if they kill us, right? Now, I do think the survival instinct is essentially universal, but we all vary in the extent to which we enjoy the curious aspect. Mere curiosity by itself is a trait that we vary in, probably most closely related to openness to experience in terms of the big five personality traits. And then within curiosity, there are more specific interests that we also might vary in, like interest in human psychology. Certainly a cool thing to be interested in. And I think that most people that are into true crime are probably interested in human psychology, right? And then there's also variation in the morbid part. Some people are just more drawn to dark or morbid topics. Some people are fascinated by natural disasters, right? Storm chasers certainly come to mind as people that are highly drawn to natural disasters in terms of the effort they're willing to put into that interest. And that, I think, again, fundamentally is related to a survival instinct, but there's variation in whether people actually enjoy what that survival instinct leads to, which is curiosity and learning more. And I think serial killers and spree killers can be thought of as a type of natural disaster, but where the nature in this case is human nature. So true crime represents these case studies in disasters of human nature or in human predators. And in turn, there's going to be this kind of innate survival-based curiosity. And again, I think true crime fans are probably a curious people. And that curiosity has kind of a morbid quality. So what might be going on in the minds/brains of people who are enjoying this type of curiosity? Well, one thing I think is a break from mental noise. I remember watching an interview with the comedian Norm Macdonald, and he was talking about gambling, with which he was known to have a problem. But he explained what made gambling so appealing to him in this way that made more sense to me than anything I had heard before. When he was betting on sports, which was his favorite, the reason he loved it so much was that when he put down, you know, thousands of dollars on a game, it was as if nothing else in his life mattered from that point on until the end of the game. Every play, he was just enraptured with what was happening, with the full force of his attention. And this was an unbelievably powerful escape from the day-to-day stressors of life. Now, true crime, I think, because it is so salient, again, because of our brain's survival instinct, it offers a similarly powerful escape from the kind of usual background noise and stress that's kind of bouncing around in our minds all day long, but without having to gamble, right? As you get invested in the details of a case, your mind just aligns its focus completely towards this thing. And I think this can be a pretty nice break from the mental chatter that might otherwise be going on in your mind. Now, what do I mean by mental chatter? I mean the kind of self-talk that's often just happening in our minds as we go about our waking life. You know, blah, 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 blah. You need to do this. You need to do that. Why did you do this? Why did you do that? And in neuroscientific terms, mental chatter, I think, is the activity of the default mode network. The default mode network is so named because it is the part of the brain, the circuits of the brain that are active by default. So when you aren't doing any one thing in particular and your mind is just sort of wandering, your default mode network is active. And that's comprised of multiple brain regions, and the activity of the network has contributions from all of these regions. If you're dealing with stressors in your life and your mood is maybe getting low, you're getting anxious, the network is thought to be getting higher contributions from regions like the dorsal medial prefrontal cortex and the anterior cingulate cortex, which are regions that can shift the focus towards negative thinking, particularly like ruminations about the past or worries about the future, and also negative self-evaluations or self-criticism. Why did I do this? Why did I do that? I'm no good, that kind of thing. So I think in those times, it might be especially attractive to have something external to your mind that brings your attention out of that default mode. To a greater or lesser extent, there's probably always something kind of enjoyable about a release just from mental noise in general. And that leads to enjoying a true crime case that's capturing your attention. So how does that shift in attention happen in the brain? I submit it's thanks to our good friend dopamine. People tend to think of dopamine as the feel-good chemical, you know, because when you get a hit of dopamine, it must feel good, right? And that's why it underlies anything that's addictive. But it can't actually be the feel-good chemical, because it also gets released just when you're expecting something good to happen, but when it hasn't happened yet. And in fact, it gets released when your brain detects a threat, which is not a good thing, right? Signs of immediate danger cause a surge of dopamine release into your cortex. So why would this be? Well, it's because what dopamine actually is the "that's important" chemical. It's your brain's way of tagging something that is important and worth paying attention to. When there's a surge of dopamine, it's your brain saying, "This is important, pay attention to it, keep paying attention to it," as long as the dopamine's going. So yes, that does include rewards or reinforcing good things like food or mating opportunities, but it definitely includes threats as well. So remember, we talked about the amygdala as the threat detector in the brain. Well, the amygdala is part of the limbic system, a major dopamine pathway that also connects to your frontal cortex, where the conscious control of your attention is also located. And so this is a pathway that's about learning or knowing what to pay attention to. None of this is as simple as just dopamine making you feel good. The pure feeling good feeling is more likely accounted for by other neurotransmitters and really endorphins, like endogenous opioids. These things, I think, fundamentally feel good to the brain, but I think they're sort of secondary to dopamine. They can happen based on whatever dopamine is doing in the brain, but it may be that those secondary effects vary in people in terms of how likely pure dopamine is to lead to a good feeling, you know, something that you want to do rather than something that you're just motivated to do. I would guess that true crime fans are people that are much more likely to enjoy the dopamine effects on attention as opposed to enjoying maybe just staying in the default mode of being non-stimulated and letting your mind wander. To seek out true crime is to seek out dopamine stimulation, I think. They may also be people who enjoy horror movies, other situations where you're enjoying the threat response in some form, right? Now, if I were going to extend this hypothesis, I would also add that if you really enjoy true crime, then maybe don't ever try cocaine, okay? Because cocaine is essentially pure dopamine. And so if you're someone that likes that dopamine-based stimulation, you probably would like cocaine too much, you know? And okay, speaking of dopamine and addiction, well, what's something else we know about that? Desensitization. So what can happen with dopamine-releasing stimuli is our brain adapts to it. So this is why people that do use cocaine, they might start as only occasionally using it, only using a small amount, but over time, the amount they have to use to get the same effect goes up. That's tolerance, right? And there becomes a point where they have to actually use cocaine just to feel normal, because if they don't use it, they're in withdrawal. So tolerance and withdrawal are examples of the price we have to pay for having a brain that is very adaptable. Our brains are always seeking homeostasis, or a return to baseline. So things that increase dopamine regularly, our brain starts anticipating that and requires a higher or stronger stimulus to get the same amount of dopamine release. So I think this can happen in true crime, and not just based on the true crime stories themselves, but based on the bombardment of threatening stimuli that we all get nowadays, thanks to the mass media, news outlets. All of these organizations are vying for your attention. And one way to do that is to present you with threatening stimuli. So news stories are generally weighted towards scary types of stories, stories of threatening violence or scary health stories. Anything that's a threat is more likely to get you to click, right? But then what your brain starts doing is adapting to an environment where there's constant threatening stimuli. And so maybe it ends up taking particularly grisly sorts of stories to get you that same degree of dopamine stimulation to, you know, click and invest your attention and energy into something. So I think desensitization ends up being both a cause and an exacerbating factor of a sort of true crime addiction. So what can you do in this world of being overstimulated and desensitized to threats? The generic advice from internet psychology websites would be to just unplug. And I don't think that's a bad idea, at least from time to time, but I'm not sure it's always viable. And I think it may be overly broad. If you're desensitized to dopamine release along one particular circuit, which is this threat detection circuit, do you need to then live like a monk and not do anything that's stimulating to you to reset that tolerance? I think our brains are a bit more elaborate than that, where these circuits each reach their own homeostasis. So you could just let one circuit reset itself to its baseline, but still get stimulation from other things in your life. So a selective break from threatening stimuli might reset that tolerance to a point. I remember saying in the first true crime video I made about the JonBenet Ramsey case, that if you're in a rabbit hole, it may be time to cease the rabbit hole, at least if you are looking for satisfaction. Because I think in a case like that, to look for satisfaction might be to chase a horizon that you're never going to get to. But on the other hand, maybe satisfaction is always just over the horizon, but only very temporarily with us. There was just an article about this on The Atlantic, about how the Rolling Stones' I Can't Get No Satisfaction was actually a prescient indictment of the state of being a human, that satisfaction is fleeting. But I think what you can know about yourself is whether or not you've saturated a certain dopaminergic circuit to the point where you're not getting those secondary good feelings that used to come with the stimulation. If you're at that point, I do think it's time to look for other things that are stimulating to you, at least for long enough to allow that circuit to reset. Sort of like if one circuit has gotten so soaked with dopamine, you have to let it spin dry. You know, you have to go through a spin dry cycle in the dryer with that part of your brain. But if you're at a point where you're getting stimulated by it and still enjoying it, shine on, you crazy diamond. And for now, I thank you for your attention, because I know that is a precious resource.